Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the regular monthly meeting of the Greenwich Board of Estimate and Taxation. Would members please rise and stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As is noted at every meeting, it is a public meeting. It is not a public hearing. There are copies of the materials that are before the board in the back of the room and two binders, as well as agendas. I believe our town budget director is running off more copies of the agenda for those in the audience who wish to follow along the deliberations of the board this evening. This evening is the last meeting within the fiscal year ending June 30th, and for those who are not routinely in attendance at our meetings, to give a sense of what transpires, normally we do have routine or interim applications, budgetary requests that fall outside of the normal budget process. Those are either deemed routine or non-routine, depending upon the subject matter. In June, we have requests from departments to carry over appropriations for capital items. That is before us this evening, and within that subject, some of those items have been deemed routine and some non-routine. Items that are routine are taken up collectively, and through one vote, those that are non-routine are taken up individually because typically discussion is required. With that explanation, I'll proceed to call upon our clerk, Ms. Rutgers, to read through the routine applications, both interim budgetary as well as improvement projects to be carried over.
We have quite a few routine applications this evening. NW1, Nathaniel Witherell, a transfer of $215,000. BA1, Commission on Aging, an additional appropriation of $4,500. GM1, GEMS, the release of conditions on $1,453,207. HD1, Health Department, approval to use grant money of $20,457. PR3, Parks and Recreation, a transfer of $40,000. Then we have the section on improvement projects to be carried over. All of these that I'm going to read are money that's appropriated in the current budget that is being asked to continue in force for the next budget year. PR1, Parks and Recreation, $22,000 for brush cutting attachment. PR2, Parks and Recreation, $18,000 for park lawn mowers. PR4, Parks and Recreation, $1 million for the new administrative office pro shop for the golf course. PW1, Department of Public Works, $20,000 for the Round Hill Road and John Street intersection. PW2, Department of Public Works, $20,000 frontage and Byram Road study. PW3, Department of Public Works, $300,000 Shore Road Bridge. PW4, Department of Public Works, $225,000 for the Riversville Road Bridge. PW5, Department of Public Works, $360,000 for the Rye Lake Road roundabout and drainage. PW6, Department of Public Works, $40,000 for the Old Greenwich Business District drainage study. PW7, Department of Public Works, $35,000 for the Greenwich Avenue streetscape plan. And PW8, Department of Public Works, $80,000 for the Central Business District Master Plan, and I would move these routine items.
Second.
They've been moved by Ms. Rutgers, seconded by Mr. Walco. Is there any discussion on those items? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
proceeding to the non-routine applications. Mr. Walco, I know we were expecting a representative from the town law department.
The budget committee did not take action on this item as the law department was there, was not there. I did see an email, I think even the next morning, by Ms. Barton advising the law department to be there or to be here at this meeting as a result of not being present at the budget committee, which was also a joint committee with the law committee and so noticed.
I've been advised that someone from the law committee, the law department, Wayne Fox, will be here tonight to present that item. I don't know why he's not here now. It is a routine traffic accident involving property damage and no personal injury, so we can deal with it however you would like to.
Would members prefer to proceed to the next items and then see if Mr. Fox arrives within the time period in which we discuss those? If Mr. Monarski, if you could just go check to see if he's in his office, we'll proceed to the next non-routine interim item.
Mr. Chairman, I think you need a motion to take this out of order then.
It's not to table, just to take it out of order.
Make the motion. So moved by Mr. Krumick, seconded by Mr. Walco. All in favor?
Aye.
Mr. Walco.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The next item is PS1, Parking Services. This is an application for improvement projects to be carried over in the amount of $350,000. This is PS1. This is for an additional appropriation of parking services for the parking structure that is adjacent to Town Hall. You should have all received a report indicating that this amount is for maintenance that needs to occur as expeditiously as possible, and therefore this is why this additional appropriation is being requested outside of the CIP process. I so move.
Moved by Mr. Walco, seconded by Mr. Simon.
The vote of the committee was 4-0 on this item.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carries 12-0-0. The next item, FD1, from the fire department. With us this evening, we have our Chief Anderson. Mr. Walco.
FD1 is a transfer of $152,000 to cover overtime salaries and regular salary lines. The committee voted 4-0 to make this application a non-routine application so that if there were questions by the BET with respect to this application, those questions could be addressed to the chief.
Are there any questions? Been moved by Mr. Walco, seconded by Mr. Simon. No questions on item FD1? Not all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carries 12-0-0. Mr. Minarski, what was the result of?
There's no one there. His office is dark. He might be en route.
Okay. Thank you for taking the time to do that. Proceeding to the next item is PS2. It's important to note that the Board of Estimate received through primarily electronic means a series of emails from individuals who are opposed to the board carrying over the architectural engineering funds that were appropriated in the 2005-2006 fiscal year for the purpose of architectural engineering design for a parking garage at Benedict Place. Those comments were circulated to members of the board. I will quickly acknowledge most, I don't know if I will be able to acknowledge all because there were so many of them, but the letter was distributed from Suzanne Geis-Robbins this evening, voicing her opposition to the proposal. We received another letter from Janet Lockton, RTM District 7, in opposition to the board's continuance of those funds. We received communication from Nancy Burke, RTM District 2. And we received a number of emails in support of continuing. Fred Putnam. Carol Zarilli sent us a letter. She's the president of the Central Greenwich Association in opposition to continuing. Mary Riviello in support. Tom Jansen in support. Iggy Makarovich in support. Don Brown in support. Dean Caparelli. Michelle Corrento in support of it. Peggy Hess. Ann Fontaine. And Tom Turley. Those were at least the ones that I received, and members were copied on some. But we do not take public comment at our regular meetings. We should post public hearings, and that's one of the reasons why I proceed in this manner. Mr. Lash has requested an opportunity to speak to this, and I call upon him at this time.
Good evening. Thank you. There has been a fair amount of email on this subject. I just want to mention a couple of things and make it clear what the money is for. First, as you know, the practice of the BET for a long time was to appropriate money for engineering and design work in one year and appropriate in another year after the engineering and design work had been completed the funds necessary to actually construct the project. This application, when it was put through originally, was meant to follow that pattern. The assumption was we would have appropriated for this coming year the money to build the building. That didn't happen, and so we're now looking at renewing this money so that we can go forward with engineering and design, consistent with the BET's longstanding practice. In the discussions we've had recently with the RTM about the CIP process, the RTM has made a couple of points that I think we probably mostly agree with. The first is that they want to have more visibility and more time to think about these projects. The second is that they would like us to do what this proposes to do, to separate the project into pieces so that they get a couple of opportunities to look at it as it progresses. So, as you recall, in this past year, we spent money that was allocated for engineering and preliminary design work for assessment of five locations around town, and that brought us to this point. And so they've now had a chance to see that. Now if we go forward with this, they'll have a chance to see this piece. And then, of course, if we succeed here with a design that's acceptable, then they'll have a chance to decide whether or not to appropriate construction money. So that's consistent with what the RTM has been encouraging us to do. And finally, there's been a question about how the money will be spent, and I think there should be no ambiguity about that. What we have to do here is what we did with the police station project. We have to begin by doing the design work and the engineering work that allow us to get to planning and zoning and to MI. And when we've gotten through MI, assuming we do get through MI, then we have to do the detailed architectural work necessary to produce the bid package. So the first $100,000 to $150,000 of this is going to be spent getting us to the point where we can get through planning and zoning and MI, and the remainder is designed to do the detailed work that's necessary in order to complete the architectural engineering work and get the bid package together. The RTM has indicated more recently that they are planning on taking up many of these MI requirements after planning and zoning has seen them. Now, whether you think that's a good practice or not, They under the charter, they only need one member to request that, and they can carry the item from planning and zoning into the RTM, and I fully expect this item will get carried forward. So if it turns out, for the sake of conversation, that we get a design that succeeds with planning and zoning and succeeds in MI, I think we're very likely at that point to see the MI in front of the RTM, and then we'll find out whether the RTM wants to go forward with the project or not. If they don't, well, then the remainder of the 690 will not be spent, and that's the end of that conversation. But if they do, then we'll spend the remainder of the 690, and presumably we'll have in the next year's budget the construction funds. So I just want to be clear, we're not just going to spend $690,000. We couldn't do that in that way if we wanted to, and nobody does want to. We have to follow this process. And we were able to get the police building to P&Z and to MI pretty economically as a percentage of the overall cost of the project. We expect to be able to do that here. So I just wanted to give you that background information, if that helps. I'd take any questions if you have any.
Mr. Stone.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Jim, earlier this evening, you quantified what you felt the top number would be to get to that stage before we had another decision to be made. Can you focus on what that might be?
Well, I think probably we're looking at some number between $120,000 and $150,000 to get all the way through planning and zoning and MI. It really depends on how many traffic studies and things of that kind that we have to do. If we get through in a straightforward way, then it will probably be less than $100,000.
And again, you can repeat for us that this would eventually lead to the RTM itself having a chance to weigh in?
Well, I think if the RTM wants to weigh in, they only need one member to do that, and they can do it at the end of the MI process. Now, if they don't weigh in, which I think is unlikely, then, of course, the project would just move forward, because I think that silence would speak volumes. But I think that it's almost a certainty that they will take this item up.
And then finally, during this process, you would expect that part of what it is that you're going to have to deliver in direct or indirect testimony would be substantiation for the ultimate benefit of the Benedict parking structure as far as moving, quote, congestion from Greenwich Avenue to this structure, as opposed to simply moving people that might be in currently in long-term parking locations?
Well, I think it's going to be difficult to prove who's going to use the structure. The Chamber of Commerce has indicated off and on over time that they thought that they, if we could build a structure like this, that they could induce people who, rightly or not, are parking in short-term parking spaces to move into this because it's only half a block off the avenue and convenient to them. And the objective was to get a fair number of those people in there, although part of that structure is designed to be used by people for short-term parking so that they could come and go. We have several studies already in hand that address the question you've raised. I think probably we're going to have to try to bring them current because some of them are now getting to be 4 years old. But we have to decide how much more money we want to spend on studies. Does that answer your question?
That's around the point. Some of these more recent studies essentially did conclude that a portion and maybe an uncomfortably large portion of the clients, the expected clients in that facility, would be relocated from, let's say, town hall parking or other long-term parking facilities, and that was what I'm certain made a number of people on the parking committee uncomfortable. Would be basically having a net gain of very little.
Yeah, I don't have the last information in front of me. There was a meeting of the parking and traffic committee at which Mr. Heimbusch, who's the head of planning and zoning, having had an opportunity to look at some data which was collected by Mr. Corey, the parking services director, in the preceding 3 or 4 weeks, and Mr. Heimbusch's view, looking at that data, was that the number of people who needed this kind of parking was so much greater than the number of spaces that we were proposing to build that he had concluded that we ought to go ahead with the project.
I remember
but
that.
I think we're still going to have to try to bring that data up to date a little bit more. And I also think, frankly, we have to get the people who operate the businesses in that part of town to come forward and make commitments to take these spaces.
Okay, and you intend to do that?
You're certainly going to try to get them to do it. I can't make them do it.
Right.
But that would be a piece of data after the fact, right?
Ms. Tarkington or Mr. Crummick and then Ms. Tarkington, because that...
Well, Ms. Tarkington, go first.
Okay, Ms. Tarkington.
I want to be gallant.
Should I just sit down for a little while?
Fine. Thank you, Ed. I think, Jim, you know, as we have talked previously, the proposed tiered parking garage is dependent upon the implementation of both the Department of Public Works study on the extended downtown district traffic flow plan, as well as obviously the parking plan to make it all work. And these combined plans, tiered parking and traffic flow, may or will materially impact parts of districts 1, 2, and 7. So I do want, you know, in terms of this money, to make sure that we're headed in the right direction. I think earlier you indicated that the cost to be spent are probably somewhat lower, perhaps in the $60,000 to $120,000 range. And I think that that's probably a fair range for the combination of the engineering studies, surveys, and the initial architectural drawings and renderings that would be presented to planning and zoning. But I also think, you know, an initial spending amount of $150,000 would keep the project moving forward, and also, you know, as we said, would fund these projects. Specific kind of items, whatever they happen to be, phase one environmentals or whatever. Nevertheless, I think that there should be additional or sufficient funds for other preliminary studies, looking at these previous traffic studies that you've done, Mr. Corey's work to really begin to inventory and catalog the existing parking, some of the changes that may be planned for Greenwich Avenue that may come in through planning and zoning or others because of change of use of buildings, and perhaps, you know, some amount of limited time should be spent by Mr. Corey working on this before proceeding with the tiered parking plan. I mean, you have any thoughts on this? Mr. Chairman, can I ask him if he has any thoughts on these additional things?
If it pertains, yes, to the use of any of the funds.
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Well, with regard to parking, as you know from the recent conversations, the Parking Services Director has now proposed a test to replace mechanical meters with automated meters. He has begun to convert some existing short-term spaces into long-term spaces as he begins to try to better match the demand for different kinds of parking against what he has available. There has been conversation off and on over the years about making more use of structured parking that already exists in the downtown area, but that requires the cooperation of the owners of that structured parking, and there's always been a certain reluctance among many of them to let that happen. But the thing that I think you can't do for the money that we're talking about in the first part of this study is you can't do another whole study on traffic circulation in the downtown area. We did that study about 4 years ago, the Central Business District Traffic Study, and some of the recommendations in that study have moved forward to implementation. Some of those are on the avenue. There is a project going on now which will mature in this time period to redesign and reconfigure Greenwich Avenue, and also to redesign and reconfigure the parks which sort of run from Town Hall over to the new public safety complex. All those things are going to come together in about this same time period. But I don't want to leave you with the thought that I'm planning on doing another Central Business District traffic study as part of this. I have to use, I think, what I have, except to the extent that planning and zoning in the normal course is going to require traffic studies around the structure. They will certainly require that.
Mr. Chairman, can I finish?
Okay.
Bring it to conclusion?
Yes, please.
I think that we should add here that the public has never really had the opportunity to comment on either the parking study nor the traffic flow study. So as Mr. Corey proceeds with this process, you know, he should keep that in mind. The comment about the cooperation of building owners, if they received their permission to do certain things from planning and zoning, and it included providing park at being the Pickwick, whatever it is up at the top of the avenue, 200 Greenwich Avenue, or Richards, we should make sure that, you know, whoever, Mr. Corey or whatever, make sure that, he works with planning and zoning and the zoning enforcement officer and that that is enforced. You know, I think that, of course, there isn't enough money to do it, another traffic study. I know that.
Well, there isn't the $690, but we're not spending that.
But there might be enough to just, as I said, consolidate the studies or just tweak anything as he's moving forward. Thank you very much for your time.
I just have a follow-up before Mr. Krumick on a point of clarification or information for the people, and that is the choice before us tonight is to carry over the full amount or to not. We can't amend the amount according to legal counsel that the charter stipulates. We either carry over the appropriation that was in fact approved by this board in the RTM, or we let it lapse. So I want to make that clear. And then follow up on, Jim, if you can, the amount that you believe you would spend to bring the proposal to the point of municipal improvement and to RTM. I mean, I know you're not going to bring it to RTM, but as you've reiterated, one person can request it come to them. So let's go under the assumption that it goes to RTM. How much of the dollars would be spent for that purpose?
Well, I think as long as we don't end up having to do some unusual studies, we ought to be able to do it for the kinds of numbers that Leslie was talking about, somewhere between $60,000 and $120,000. She's suggested $150,000 is an outside figure. We're going to have a handle on that when we actually go out and hire the architects and engineers. If it's some other number, I'd be happy to come back and talk with you about it, and we can talk about whether we want to spend that amount.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Krumick.
I think there's been some confusion as to what the BET's role is tonight. And you touched on this, Mr. Chairman. I don't think I've ever called you that. I used to call you Peter. But you touched on it. We're here just to decide whether we're going to encumber funds that have already been appropriated. A year ago, we had the appropriation decision by the BET and by the RTM, and they said, go ahead, here's the money. We've raised the money. It's already been raised from taxes. So the only question, I think, for us as a BET is, do we think that this project is proceeding? And the first selectman assures us it is proceeding. And under what I view as a narrow discretion, we should encumber the funds. And that's our only, I think that's our only role. We're not here to examine or re-examine whether the appropriation should have been made. We're certainly not here to evaluate traffic. That's a P&Z role. And we're not here to opine or guess at what the RTM would do with a municipal improvement status. We have a very limited role. And I think, judging by the emails pro and con we've received, there's some confusion in the public as to what it is we're doing here today. It's not to appropriate funds. It's merely to encumber or not encumber funds in the amount already appropriated and already raised.
Thank you, Mr. Krumick. Mr. Walco.
Mr. Chairman, I think we have yet to move this item. So if I may offer the report on the Budget Committee, and I'd like to move PS2 Parking Services improvement projects to be carried over in the amount of $690,000.
Okay, thank you. That's been moved, seconded by Mr. Simon, and now proceed with your report.
The Budget Committee voted 4-0 to approve the carrying over of this amount. By way of historical background, this amount was approved in the 05-06 budget, was approved by the BET Budget Committee and then the BET in February and March of 2005, and then approved by the RTM in May of 2005. The first selectman, this item then came before us, or a corresponding item came before us during our deliberations of the 06-07 budget in the form of the construction project costs for the parking structure. At that time, the Budget Committee voted 3-1 in favor of that application. And the full BET then, or no member of the BET, sought its reinstatement. And ultimately, the RTM passed the budget this past May without the construction project funds. As a result of our annual review of all projects, including many that we have already voted on this evening, we have continued to, in essence, roll over several capital projects. This being just one of the items, the Budget Committee decided to offer this up as a non-routine item because of the importance of the matter. After the Budget Committee voted against this project in February of this past year, in terms of the construction costs, we received several emails and correspondence, some indicating that the BET was setting policy that it should not be setting. Personally, I disagreed with those comments, but we still heard from a number of groups, and now we're deliberating this item once again. At the BET Budget Committee this past week, the Budget Committee voted 4-0 to roll the money over, so that, in fact, we could have a public dialogue on this project. I quite frankly wish I had asked the questions that have been asked of you tonight, Mr. First Selectman, through Mr. Stone, regarding where the money or how the money was going to be appropriated, and I appreciate your comments. It would have been helpful if one of us on the Budget Committee had been so smart to ask those questions then. But I feel comfortable in recommending this going forward on behalf of the committee, 4-0.
Okay. Ms. Barton?
Where I'm troubled is with the amount of information that appears to be new information that people are raising in terms of how much space is actually available for parking in the business district that's not being used or that's being used by people other than the people that we thought would use it, and how that overlaps with who in fact would use a multi-tiered garage on Benedict Place, and whether it's the right group of people. And that the fact that there is so much information that appears to be new is really troubling me in terms of whether we should roll this money over for another year, if you'd care to address that.
Sure. Well, and of course, a lot of this information, because it's not your assignment to go to the Parking and Traffic Committee meetings all the time, you wouldn't have heard, but a lot of it has been discussed along the way. One of the sort of recurring complaints that we get is that the sort of the classic example is the lot across from the car dealership. They park their customers' cars in there. They have a little crew of people who shuttle cars back and forth. It's a long-term parking lot intended for day commuters, not for people who work in the city. You can't make a long-term purchase in there until after 9 o'clock. So people complain about that. But as has been pointed out by the police department on a number of occasions, those people have a legal right to use the parking lot in that way as long as they put the money in the machines. And so it upsets people, but it's not illegal. It's not improper. There was a criticism of the use of the parking structure here next to Town Hall that we had sold permits for parking cars that belong to employees of car dealerships who were out on the post road. But that was done years and years ago when this lot was not being utilized. They were trying to induce people to use it. So some of these decisions about who parks in these facilities are either the result of the working of law or they're the result of decisions that were made years ago. With regard to this particular location, one of the reasons this location was chosen was because it matches well with the Central Business District traffic flow, which is designed to bring people up and into that side of town without bringing them down through Greenwich Avenue or across Greenwich Avenue. And second, there are already two other tiered parking structures immediately adjacent to that location, so it's a place that's already a desirable parking place. But more importantly, the studies that have been done, and there have been a number of them now, show that there is a very substantial unmet demand for long-term parking in the upper end of the avenue for people who work on the avenue. And the data shows that those people are currently parking on the avenue and feeding quarters into the machines, even though that's against town ordinance. Now, whether we can actually relocate those people and therefore free up spaces on the avenue, which is the objective that we all have, I don't think we know at the moment, but there are some strategies available for dealing with that. So there isn't very much that has sort of come up lately that is actually new. Now I've already addressed that. Do you have something in particular that sounded new to you?
No, you've covered the issues that I've seen raised. I guess what we're saying is that for an expenditure that we hope will not exceed $150,000, but we can't guarantee that, we will buy the ability to have a public debate at the RTM.
Well, I think that's right.
That's a very expensive discussion.
Well, actually, it's cost a lot more than that. Because we spent about that amount of money this year on the studies that led to the recommendation for this site, and in the years before that, we've spent money in the last 4 years on a couple of other studies. So probably the cost of that vote's closer to $500,000, but that's the cost of democracy in Greenwich. The problem we have is that we do much better at making decisions when we have specific concrete propositions in front of us than we do when we're having kind of philosophical debates. The philosophical debating goes on about once a decade in the plan of conservation and development process, where we bring in outside experts, we bring in people with approaches to urban planning and zoning holds public meetings all around town to bring that document up to date. And we're starting that process now. The 10-year cycle is coming up. Louisa Stone, who is here, sort of led that process a few years ago. I'll be having dinner with her later this week, and she'll be giving me an earful about parking structures over my main course, I'm sure. but we have the generalized debate in that forum. When I ran for election the first time in 2003, I took a couple of surveys, at least one of which was infamous. And one of the things that those surveys showed was that among the voting public, there's a very strong demand for more parking in the downtown business district. But that's not the same as saying that when you put a specific parking proposal in front of people, particularly in front of the RTM, that they will want, in fact, to go forward with that. And what I've promised people is not that I would take a doctrinaire view about parking, which I have not, but that I would bring them a project they could actually vote on. And I'm happy to do that for as little money as possible here. But my hope would be that we would have something specific that they could vote on, and then they'll take whatever position they take.
Mr. Finger.
I'd like to echo many of the comments that Ms. Barton mentioned. What I think I did hear were some recent developments. You mentioned that Mr. Corey is doing a further study of tweaking the number of short-term parking and long-term parking, making an attempt to try to convince some of the shop owners to have their employees park in other areas so that they would free up spaces in front of their stores. That sounds like some new initiatives that have taken place. And primarily, they are initiatives to better manage our current inventory. So I think with that as a possibility for alleviating some of the problems, I do think, notwithstanding what Greenwich's traditions are, it is an expensive proposition to have a debate on a piece of property.
Thank you, Ms. Tarkington.
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to follow up on a couple of points that have been raised here, and which I think are very important points to be raised. One, I think Mr. Crummock talked about parking and traffic being the responsibility of planning and zoning. And I think in these particular cases, both the traffic flow plan and the parking plan were commissioned and managed by the Department of Public Works. I truly believe there would have been substantially more public input, and we might not be having this debate today if these studies had been prepared by planning and zoning. And in fact, we voted earlier on two studies, a Greenwich Avenue streetscape plan and a central business district master plan, both of which are being done by the Public Works and DPW are the other department responsible. And I do think that planning should be the responsibility of the planning and zoning department. I think no matter what happens this evening, there are some budget lessons learned for the RTM that everyone, including the BET and the RTM, need to look very closely at every item in the budget, and that $690,000 really gets lost in a very large Department of Public Works budget. And so, you know, that can be an issue. I'd also like to raise a couple of other issues. One is, I would hope that before anything begins here, and especially you as a financial, with financial background, would have Mr. Corey prepare pro forma financial statements of the annual operating costs for this new parking facility if it's, you know, prior to starting the architectural studies, and including the insurance and the cleaning and lighting, the maintenance, the operating and the reserves, how it will be managed 24/7, especially after hours. Additional police cruiser time to go through there, because it's going to be really fun for the skateboarders with those ramps. And, you know, really understanding, even in Greenwich, whether parking garages invite crime. In addition, you know, I'll put on the record that I've been parking in one of Greenwich's parking garages for several decades. And, you know, there are security issues and safety issues and cleanliness issues. And so I think these issues also need to be addressed or thought how we will handle those better if we take on the responsibility, and it is a responsibility of another parking garage. Thank you.
Mr. Himes.
The information that we've been provided over the last couple of days has been very interesting. And as I was reflecting on it, became very clear that I'm not a land use person, and ultimately we're not a board, I think, that should be making decisions on land use. And I think there are probably better venues for public opinion to be expressed. To me, I take a slightly more expansive view than Ed does about our role. To me, we are being asked to approve up to $690,000 for a project which we are now presented with new information versus the appropriation. One is a specific location, and two is a lot of community concern. So it does strike me that we're being asked to approve perhaps $150,000, but up to $690,000, which may or may not ultimately lead to a real project. So like Nancy, it does seem like a big price for a debate. Given that, my question to the first selectman is, given what we now know about community opposition, if nothing else, the debate that is raging, given that there will be a plan of conservation and development developed in the next couple of years, given that Mr. Corey will provide us with new information, my question is, what specifically leads to the urgency that we undertake this study in this place for this amount of money right now?
Well, the first off, as I've tried to make as clear as I can, this is something that we've been working on for 4 years. This isn't something urgent that just came upon us. Second, the debate was always going to be loud and energetic, because the town has a long history of opposing these kinds of projects. The classic example of that was the opportunity that the town passed up to have town parking in the Richards project back, how many years ago now, Ed? Eight, nine?
That long ago?
Yeah, it was before I was on the BET, so it was
95.
Back in the 90s. That was a classic opportunity, and I think to this day there are still strong feelings about whether we should have created more parking there that would have been public parking or not. But if you try to find a place to park in the Richards lot after hours, which they allow, that's one of those cooperative arrangements that was being talked about, it's full. That end of the avenue is very busy. So if not now, when, I think is the point. We've done 1, 2, 3, 4, probably 5 studies in the last 3.5 years that have led us step by step by step to determining the amount that was needed, the kind of facility that would be needed, assessed the 5 locations the town owns in the downtown area, narrowed it down to 2, narrowed the 2 down to 1. We've brought ourselves here in this very methodical way, and now we're at the point where we have to decide. But I was accused at an RTM meeting earlier of bullying the RTM. I don't flatter myself that I'm capable of bullying the RTM, but I could have already spent this $690,000. Nothing stopped me back 3 months ago from putting out a contract and moving ahead. But it was obvious then that with the studies completed, people wanted an opportunity to have the conversation we're having tonight, and so we didn't let that contract, we didn't spend that $690,000, and we haven't moved ahead. But now we're at that point. If we don't roll this money, and if we don't then begin the detailed studies for a structure on the site that's been chosen, then I think conservatively we're looking at 2 or 3 years, and at the outside 4 or 5 years before we return to having a concrete project in front of us again, because we will get into the POCD process and then people will say, let's wait until we get to the end of that. That's okay with me. I'm not pressing this project. I'm saying we've carried this project to this point. We've spent quite a lot of money already to get here very methodically. The meetings have, in fact, been held in public by the Parking and Traffic Committee. They've been noticed properly. The agendas have been public. People have known we were having these conversations. Some of your members have been there. Members of Planning and Zoning sit on the Parking and Traffic Committee. But members of the RTM attend those meetings. But still, we haven't had the sort of vigorous debate that people are eager to have. My preference is to let them have that debate with a specific project in front of them, but you may choose otherwise. If you do, I won't be upset as I leave the room tonight. It'll give me one less project I have to worry about this year, and I can have a calmer dinner with Louisa later in the week.
Well, there'll be another issue.
Yeah, well, that's probably right.
Are there further comments from members of the board? Mr. Krumick?
I realize that for new members of the board who weren't here when this money was appropriated, this seems like a new thing, but it really isn't a new thing. When we passed this appropriation, and I can assure you that a $690,000 appropriation did not slide under the radar either of the BET or the RTM, the idea was they would use this money to find a location, develop a plan. That plan would have to go through planning and zoning. It probably would go through RTM municipal improvement review, and this was all going to be done before construction money was appropriated. That's why we break up architectural and engineering appropriations in 1 year, and with the anticipation if the project goes forward, we'll do construction funding in a subsequent year. So this is not, we're following the same plan that was approved by the BET and the RTM when they passed this appropriation. It's slid a year, but that's again why we have this process where we review encumbrances, and I'm sorry, I don't believe we go back and go through the whole broad review that we would give if this was an appropriation. It's not. Question is, do we encumber the funds because the project is going forward? And and I think it's pretty clear that the project is going forward exactly where we're supposed to be, to the Planning and Zoning Commission, which is best equipped to review things like design, like traffic, things like that, impact, how it fits into the plan of conservation and development, and then the RTM, which is, as they remind us, a very representative body.
Mr. Walco?
Just a few last comments. I think the Budget Committee got it right in February in denying the construction money. I think it's allowed us to have this debate tonight. It's allowed us to have the dialogue, the numerous telephone conversations and emails that I'm sure we've all received in the last few days. It's allowed us to be here tonight to talk about it, and it's allowed us to sort of pull together and quantify the 690. But I also believe it is, in listening to both sides, business owners, residents, citizens of all shapes and sizes, that it's important to have this public dialogue, and I do believe it's important to have the dialogue on a specific project and not in the abstract. And for that, I'm in support of rolling this money over, especially in light of the assurances by the first selectman this evening.
Mr. Mason?
I would like to first understand how Mr. Crummick and Mr. Lash can say the same thing. It's a little bit out of the norm. This project,
partisanship.
This project goes way back. We had discussions at the Budget Committee of not continuing forward about how much of Greenwich Avenue we would like to tear up at one time between the police department and the upper Benedict Place. And we had, obviously, as you heard in a report before, we had a 3-1 vote on that. As a citizen, I have a stance on parking structures. But in this particular case, this item has gone through selectmen's parking traffic. As Mr. Lash said, it could have easily been committed. I think that the precedent here is that the discussion had to happen. We had some offline discussions about not carrying this forward, bringing it back as an interim appropriation. I think the RTM would say, well, you're acting out of the CIP process, so that would run into that issue. Because the revenues that will fund all of this come from parking revenues, out of the parking fund and not out of the tax levy, we had that to bring it back as a separate issue. And we sat down and we looked at it. We said, okay, if the first selectman chooses to go to the BET and the RTM on an interim basis for an estimated $150,000 to get it to MI, the BET RTM could have the discussion then. Or do we want to continue on the process that's been established, and get the process to MI, see if it ever makes it through MI, then the RTM can have with the discussion then, and then when it comes back for further funding to continue the project, there'll be even more discussions then. So there's a minor difference here, as if we did it on an interim basis or we did it as part of the continuing the way we're going. As I said before, I think most of the members know where I stand on parking structures, but I think this is an RTM decision. This is a obviously financial, but it's a policy decision of the town, and what do we want our town to look like in the central business district.
Ms. Barton?
I have a question for whoever knows the answer. Is there any way that we can satisfy ourselves that no more than approximately $150,000 would be spent getting through the MI process and giving the RTM its opportunity to debate the issue? They either will or won't take that opportunity, but that's their business. But can we somehow make that concrete so that instead of spending nearly $700,000, the expenditure is a lot lower in the event the project does not go forward?
I believe that question was posed to Mr. Fox in the town council's office in terms of the process we follow as to carrying the full balance of the funds over or reducing them. And I believe the response that was received by Mrs. Tarkington was that it was all or nothing. You either do not carry the funds over or you carry them over, but you cannot amend because it's an appropriation. It was already approved by the RTM. Alternately, though, I think what Ms. Barton, you're saying is if I believe what we have is assurance from the first selectman, verbal assurance in a public meeting attended by numerous town officials that he will not exceed roughly $150,000 out of the 690. And I think each of us have to make the determination if that is our only mechanism whereby we it's either 690 or let it lapse. And if you're going to go, say, carry the 690 over, we have to take Mr. Lash at his word and go forward on that basis of trust. And I'm willing to do that. But while we have the town council here, if you want to reiterate that or...
But not beyond, to limit it in any way, then I think the framers of this section of the charter would have and could have said that, but they did not. And as I read this section of the charter, what you have the ability and right to do is to continue that appropriation. So in my opinion, it is up or down vote. It's not some or part of, it's not a modification of.
Thank you, Mr. Fox. Ms. Barton, is that satisfactory to your...
Can we ask that, Jim, that you would come back and talk to us if it looks as if it's going to be more than that?
Sure. Yeah, actually, what I would suggest, given the anxiety with my reliability here...
Please don't take my question as an indication of that.
That's okay. What I would suggest is when we get the bids back and we've selected architects and engineers and we have a project plan and a budget, we send it to you. If it's anything different than the kinds of numbers we've been talking about, then I think we're going to end up talking about it again. That way you'll know what we know.
Mr. Finger?
I think you said earlier, Mr. Lash, that when you're talking about the amount of money you think it would take to take it to the MI, you said assuming additional traffic studies were not required. So that's suggesting there are certain potential for cost increases well beyond your control and beyond what might appear in any kind of proposed contract that you would receive from an engineer or architectural firm. So my concern, following up on what Ms. Barton was talking about, was if we're looking for some indication that it would not exceed 150, or if it looked like it would, you would come back to us. My concern is it may initially look like 150 or something short of that. We get into the process, and all of a sudden we find that it's going to cost us more, and we've spent $150,000 or $100,000, and now where are we going? We're back to where we started from. And again, that's, to me, a lot of money to spend to have a debate.
Well, actually, that's the constant complaint about the town's land use review process. You can't know whether you're going to find a wetland on your property. You can't know whether you're going to find a contaminant on your property. You can't know whether additional studies will be required or whether planning and zoning will look at your first traffic study and say, well, we'd like you to do it again in a different way. You can't know that. But having said that, I think if you want to have the debate based on a specific project, you're going to have to spend the money. If you want to have the debate in concept, you don't have to spend any more money at all. We can move on to the debate and concept. Again, I think you're better off debating specifics, but believe me, any decision you make tonight will be fine with me.
Ms. Tarkington?
I agree with Mrs. Barton that this is an expensive lesson for the town to learn. But in many ways, I consider even looking at this with a cap on the, we'll call it the first phase, a compromise. Because when I asked for detail, as requested by one of my fellow members here, on the breakdown of the costs for the $690,000, the only information I got back, if I got a great response, was design build. And I think probably what would have happened was everything would have been completed, and it would have gone to planning and zoning with pretty detailed drawings, et cetera, for this project. One thing that hasn't really been talked about is how does a project for the new department get constructed? Unlike, say, Nathaniel Weatherall or the Board of Education, where there's a charter-required town building committee, when the new charter amendment was done.
Ms. Tarkin, I have to.
Is that out of order?
I think that's proceeding beyond the scope of what the appropriation.
I'm sorry. I thought I was going to get. Anyway, we'll drop that subject. But anyway, I think that the other thing we can comment here on is that the project will be getting a lot of public scrutiny at planning and zoning, and the public can always come to the planning and zoning meetings just the way it would in any other kind of compromise kind of structure. And the public then also has the opportunity to comment through the MI process. So the public comment opportunities are very similar. And, you know, and what I've heard you say is that you plan to spend, phase this project with the first phase sort of capped at $150,000.
Mr. Stone, and then Mr. Crummick and Mr. Norton, and then I would ask if there isn't any other new comments or questions that we can wrap up the discussion on this topic.
Thank
so
you,
Stone,
Chair.
Crummick, and Norton in that order.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just to put a fine point on the outside amount here, during our caucus, we covered this area exhaustively, and I'd say there's no question in my mind, and now I'm sure that people here this evening will clearly remember the extensive discussion we've had concerning the magnitude. So that there is there's no doubt that should Jim find that there will be, in order to get through MI or other processes before it gets to the RTM, additional monies that need to be spent, I'm sure he will bring this back to us for a second look. I have no question about it.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Stone. Mr. Crummick?
I hear words like caps, and I hear words like 150,000 thrown out there. I think what we've heard tonight is an estimate from the first selectman of what they think it will cost to put this project through the MI process, but they really don't know. What he has assured us, and I think we can all take him at his word, is that they plan to as a first step, take this through the MI process and not to go to the next step, which is to have actual construction drawings done. And that's what he's assured us. The rest is an estimate. He's also said that if it looks like he's going to exceed that range, he'll come back and he'll let us know for informational purposes. But in terms of what we're doing tonight, it's encumber the full amount or not encumber the full amount. And I think we have some comfort that the first selectman is planning to do exactly what we thought he would do, which is to take this thing stage by stage and use this money wisely. And the next stage is the municipal improvement stage.
And the only point I would make is, as I said earlier, if I had wanted to do something different, I would have already started spending the 690. So.
Thank you, Mr. Lash. And finally, Mr. Norton.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. It seems to me that because money has been appropriated and the site has been identified, what is important to me is that having done that, that a public debate take place. And I think what this discussion has done tonight has created a framework for that debate. And I certainly do believe, with all the time I spent on the RTM, that the RTM is representative of the town. And that's the most positive location for that debate to occur.
Great, thank you. No, there's no further comment. We'll proceed to vote. The item was moved by Mr. Walco. Seconded by Mr. Simon. All those in favor, if you can raise your hand, it would be helpful. Norton, I can't see. Norton, Mason, Simon, Stone, Walco, Tessie, Rutgers, Crummick, Tarkington, Himes. Opposed? Barton, Finger. So that is carried over on a vote of 10 in favor, 2 opposed. I see we have the town council here, Mr. Fox. Mr. Fox, we proceeded along with our agenda this evening, and we're awaiting your arrival, so now we're at the point where item SEL1 is before us.
Good evening.
Is this an executive session?
Given the amount involved and the nature of the damages, do we really have to go into executive session to discuss it?
You have the right to go into executive session, but I tend to think in light of the nature of the issues involved, I'm not uncomfortable with you doing it in open session.
Okay, that's fine then.
Let me first of all say, when I had seen the length of your agenda, I didn't realize that you would get to me as quickly as you did, so I apologize.
That's quite all right.
For my tardiness. This matter, in my opinion, is straightforward. It has been before the Board of Selectmen, has been before the Claims Committee, has been approved by both. Unfortunately, it was an accident which occurred back in February of 2005. At that time, the claimant was traveling east on Station Drive when a town employee was traveling north on South Shore Drive. A witness who was traveling directly behind the town's vehicle reported that the driver of the town's vehicle did not come to a complete stop and struck the right front of the claimant's vehicle. Although the individuals involved were both taken to the hospital, I'm pleased to report that there has been no claim for any bodily injury. The only claim before us is a subrogation claim. It involves repair damages of $9,870.57 plus a deductible of $500 for a total amount of $10,370.57. I would indicate to you that the formal submission to you actually contained a number which was slightly higher. It was $10,997, which included some ER expenses which were not paid and so not recoverable. So the total amount we are requesting that you approve is the $10,370.57 for the damage done to the vehicle plus the deductible.
So moved.
It's a move by Mr. Crummick, seconded by Mr. Norton.
Could you repeat the exact number again?
Yes, sir.
It's different from than what appears on our.
Yes, sir, it is.
Okay.
It is $10,370.57.
Mr. Simon?
And this includes money for the EMS transportation?
It does not. No, sir.
Does not.
That's the difference between the number you have and this number.
All right.
That's some $626.43, which is not being sought in terms of recovery.
Mr. Norton?
Mr. Fox?
Yes, sir.
Would you anticipate having us be segregated or a bill for that come forward at some point in time?
No, sir, I do not.
Thank you.
Further questions? If not, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Fox.
You.
That concludes the interim applications as well as the improvements to be carried over. Proceeding to item number 3, the Human Resources Committee actions and report. I just want to note for Mrs. Cass with us and Mrs. Krieger, upon completion of the
healthcare budget status report, I'm going to request a motion from the members of the board to take up the item that relates to the MC compensation, the GWI, so that you do not have to wait until the end of our deliberations to address us on that.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Good evening.
Good evening.
You have before you the summary of the active employee health care and the OPEB budget. We continue to remain under budget 11 months into our fiscal year. I hate to keep saying the same things to you every month, but we are still below headcount and have remained about 20 to 25 positions below headcount all fiscal year, which is a significant reason. There is also plan design changes and higher cost shares of the employees that have all contributed to this $641,000 under budget. OPEB is just slightly different between the premium equivalents and the revenues received, and that is typically because of the timing of the payments. So we do remain under budget. Any questions?
Any questions, Mr. Simon?
Yes. Do you know the results? Were there a lot of changes in the open enrollment period this year with people changing plans?
No, there was not a lot, actually. There was really quite a few. I believe about 430.
That's not many at all.
No, very few.
I mean, what to me is most interesting is that the pharmacy for the town active employees continues to be far under budget. And the teachers are going into the three-tier starting July 1st, which will make this number even less.
Right.
And it would be helpful at some point in time if we could find out through either your analysis, Caremark's analysis, or Ovation's analysis, what's driving this, whether we have long-term trends, we have a better people using pharmacies more cautiously or economically. But you know, in the budget alone, this is the biggest number. This
yes,
is the biggest change.
We have asked Ovation to take a look at this, and they have, in fact, asked for data from Caremark. So we are expecting a report. We'll give you some of those figures.
Yeah, thank you.
Also help us for the coming fiscal year in terms of pricing.
Yes, and a budget for next year.
Yes, I know.
Any other questions? Is there a motion to accept the health care budget status report for the month? Moved by Mr. Simon. Second by Mr. Norton. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. The at this time, if I could have a motion to take up the item that's under new business, approval of change in annual GWI for MC employees for the fiscal year. Moved by Ms. Tarkington. Is there a second? Seconded by Ms. Rutgers. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Ms. Cass, if you can give, for the benefit of the new members particularly, a little bit of the history as to the establishment of the managerial and confidential class compensation plan and how, in effect, it works and why this is before us. I know prior to that, being adopted, the BET acted annually on general wage increases for these non-represented employees, in addition to looking at salary schedules for these employees based upon market analysis. So that was pre-MC compensation plan, and now that's been adopted and been put into effect. If you can just give a you know, what happened from 2004 to date and why we're at this point this evening to look at this.
Okay. The MC compensation plan, which was approved by the BET in, I believe, January of 2004, was an attempt to take what is approximately 46 or 47 of the town's top managers who are unrepresented by a union, primarily your department heads, deputy department heads, and commissioners, and put them into a pay plan where they would have a grade and a step based upon their job duties and their responsibilities, and they would move forward every year based upon performance within their grade. Part of that plan was also to review the grades every year and make comparisons to the GWI and to the union raises to ensure that this group was not in a position where we were being compressed to the subordinates in the unions, which is what had occurred in 2003. The union's pay plan are steps and GWIs every year, whereas the MCs up until that time were coming to the BET every year for just a GWI. So it didn't take long for some of the higher paid union employees to be making almost as much as their managerial counterparts. So we were essentially had subordinates who were making almost as much as the managers. The concept was to put them on steps and grades like the union counterparts and to keep it that way based upon performance until such time as we had reached outcome-based budgeting, in which case we would move towards an outcome-based performance management scheme, and raises would be based upon that. So I handed out the salary grades and steps tonight before the start of your meeting, which gives you the 04s, the 05s, and the 06s. That's it. I did put one at everyone's place. This is really quite simple. This is what was approved by the BET in January of 04. You can look at all the various managerial titles. Represents the grades they're currently classified to, and then the steps. The first year, we kept the GWI at 3%, which was actually lower than the union counterparts. If you look at the second page, you have the general wage increase chart that shows you what the unions have been getting each year. So last year, the MC were at 3%. I believe all their union counterparts were at 3.25%. This year, since the finance department tends to put our budgets together in December and January, Roland, in calculating the budget, put the 3% in because that is what we had used last year. When I actually looked at the GWIs this year and compared them with the CPI, I determined that 3.25% was more appropriate, particularly since we didn't want to run into another situation of compression. So that's why it changed. I've also attached Article 17 from a GMEA contract, because that is exactly the same language that we use to calculate the GWI. Section 2, we look at the CPI for urban, clerical, and administrative wage earners, and we also look at the raises that the unions are receiving and compare the two. So essentially, the plan is in place. It was approved. I did share this information with the HR committee earlier this month. And are there any questions?
Ms. Tarkington, do you want to report on your committee's deliberations at this time?
Mr. Chairman, I was going to do that. Just solely on this topic or the whole committee?
Just on this topic at this time, please.
Yes, as Ms. Cass commented, the HR committee reviewed information about the history of the current MC step and grade policies, information about salary increment increases for the town's unions, and historic CPI data, as well as other information. The HR committee also considered the recommendation by Mrs. Cast and her concern about salary compression of the MC employees and the union employees. We felt this incremental raise was very appropriate. In addition, prior to the meeting, I advised Joan Caldwell of the RTM, who's with us this evening, the action the committee would take at the meeting. The HR committee concluded this section of its meeting by approving the recommended 3.25% incremental salary increase. The further, I think the incremental amount is really, it was around $12,000. We received that information in advance of the meeting, and we felt that that was an amount that the various departments would be very willing to absorb into their budget. It was not substantial for any department. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Tarkington. Are there further comments on this, Mr. Walco?
I guess I still don't understand the process since we developed the MC compensation plan. My understanding was we were supposed to go out and do a field study when that was first approved. I want to say now it's going back a few years. Has that field study been completed?
No. Actually, I'm just contracting for a field study. We had done a field study, actually. Human Resources had done one in 0203. It was a hay study that had actually put all of these jobs into a grade and on steps. I am in the process now of identifying a consultant to come in and do a study of all executive compensation. And we do have Connecticut Conference of Municipality reports, but I don't feel that that's really a significant apples-to-apples comparison. So we are, HR is hiring a consultant to do that, although I don't imagine we will have the results until the end of this year.
So, but my understanding was that all appointing authorities had control of the HR compensation plan, and you needed unanimous support for changing it.
I haven't changed it.
Well, no, I'm not suggesting that you are, but so you, is it that we're supposed to approve these increases every year?
Well, it's the increases every year are basically a GWI, and I believe that in the original approval, the GWI was supposed to be done every year based upon CPI and union raises with a consultant study every 2 to 3 years to make sure that all of the executive compensation was still in an appropriate range.
So when would we next?
You do also
review this, the ranges and the steps in the compensation plan?
When I have the results of the consultant study.
I mean, at this time, I think if this is here in fact, because you're going from 3% to 3.25%.
Right, that's
and so
the only
it was
reason.
Adopted, it was 3% for two
right.
consecutive years, I believe, because we had a discussion on this. And I know Mr. Simon has raised issues more broadly about who administers the plan. I think that's a discussion for the HR committee to work on in delineating. But I think it's here tonight. The members should know, one, because it is a change to the rate that was established at the
right.
time of adoption. And there are a number of new members whom are not necessarily familiar with the plan. And I thought it was important that they hear from you about it.
I don't believe that there was ever a lock on a 3% increase per year when it was adopted. I don't recall that. I know that there was an attempt to put a GWI in every year based upon certain indices, but not that it be no more than 3%.
Right. Now, the GWI is tied to performance, or the step is tied?
The step is tied to performance. The GWI is tied to the union increases and the CPI, and, of course, the overall consulting studies that we're supposed to be doing every 2 to 3 years to make sure that the ranges are not out of line with our peers in other comparable municipalities.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Simon?
I think when we passed the MC plan, I don't think we ever specified a GWI. And I think the first year they came to us and asked for the GWI. The second year, no one came to us. The third year, which I think is this year, you came to us. And I think every year you should come to us to get the GWI approved. And as mentioned here before, when you compare yourselves to the costs of the increases in the other union contracts, you have to understand that that's based upon changes in benefits. And I urge very strongly that when we do the study for the market, we look at the whole benefits package to make sure that the benefits that are being paid the MCs are in line with what we're paying the rest of the employees, or providing the rest of the employees, and we're looking at a total compensation package.
That is
and
correct.
I think this has to get done through the HR department and the HR committee between now and next June.
Oh, yes. We have already begun to put together total compensation figures.
Because I think that's all that really matters, is what we pay people for total compensation relative to what the market is and what, mm-hmm. and relative to what we pay other people in the town.
Mm-hmm. Further comments? Mr. Stone.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just following on to this same issue, something that's come up in the audit committee concerned the MC contribution match, which I know has been subject of a draft memorandum, a policy memorandum on the policy, and I know it's part of the overall compensation plan, and I don't want to have it not discussed tonight if you're ready to begin discussion of that this evening. You know what I'm referring to?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
401K.
Mr. Chairman, the 401K was also a topic at the HR committee meeting. Do you want me to say
anything? Well, I think we need to stay focused on the item that's on the agenda. When we conclude this, you can report on the other actions of the committee, and then it's more germane to take it up. I think Mr. Stone's point is well taken, that that's one of the provisions contained in the plan that needs to be looked at, as Mr. Simon has said, and we've acknowledged.
The consultant study will involve a total compensation review, not just salaries.
Mr. Walco?
I'm delighted to hear that we're going to do this study. I think it's a couple years overdue, but I guess I'm a little puzzled. I thought when we entered into the MC compensation plan, we were trying to go away from doing yearly or appropriating yearly GWI increases. I thought it seems like we've just gone full circle, and we still now have a plan, but now we call them steps, and we're going to have a debate about GWI for MC employees, where I thought our goal was to almost have it on automatic pilot with these reviews by consultants to make sure that we're in line. So I don't think it's for tonight, Mr. Chairman, but I hope that we can revisit this issue and to fully understand what we did several years ago in terms of the MC compensation plan, because I'm not sure we envisioned having annual reviews of GWIs. That's what we used to do.
Well, I think it's an issue that's going to be before the HR committee in terms of the administration of the entire plan. I think caution was exercised this evening to bring this before the board, one, in light of the fact it was a change in what was in effect for 2 years in terms of the 3% going to 3.25%. And in terms of whether or not it had to come here or not, we again erred on the side of caution, mm-hmm. one, in having the board look at it and give it its thumbs up or thumbs down. And more important, I thought it was important for members of the board who are new to understand and learn about it. It's apparent that even members who approved it are not comfortable with the provisions contained in it yet. And I don't think that's necessarily the fault of any one individual. I just think it's something that requires further examination. Ms. Tarkington.
Mr. Chairman, the memo talks a great deal about compression. It doesn't talk about any 3% or 3.25%. And so obviously Ms. Cast has mentioned compression several times in her comments, and I think this is an important issue to remember, that we do have to keep our management employees in line with the people who report to them, and you know, this seemed to be the best manner in which to handle it this year.
Right, Mr. Fleming?
Well, I just encourage the HR committee to keep on top of changes in MC compensation, both in terms of the GWI, but also in terms of benefits, because I think that's an important part of the oversight role of this board, and frankly, I'm not uncomfortable with annual reviews as part of the budget process.
Mr. Gomo, you had your hand up.
Yeah, I just wanted to remind everyone that those meetings
Thank you. Further questions for Ms. Cast? Ms. Tarkington, you move to approve this change?
I move to approve this change. It was unanimously approved by the Human Resources Committee.
Is there a second? Seconded by Mr. Norton. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Opposed? Thank you, Ms. Cast. The next item is the assessor's report, and Mr. Gortney is not with us this evening. He is, and he advised me in the middle of May that he would not be available for this meeting as he was given an opportunity to participate in a UN Habitat panel to regarding third world urban forum on sustainable cities. He's going to be speaking on real property assessments as a basis for municipal finance. He's doing this on his own time. The costs are covered by the organization, but there are some 6,000 delegates at this conference in 150 countries attending. So I think it speaks well of our assessor that he's been called upon by an organization such as this to share his talents.
And his assistant, who attends all our meetings?
His assistant did not want to attend the meeting.
That's why he's the assistant.
He said he would like to, he requested approval to miss the meeting, and he will answer any questions on his report upon returning. So if members did have questions on his report, email them to him. He will be with us in July. And as just a point of information, I know that both Ms. Tarkington and Ms. Barton are proceeding with their work on revaluation and plan on having a schedule for that in July. So thank you, too. I know you've held a number of discussions with him, and the questions have been presented to him, and he's working on addressing them.
I don't think we need to move or to accept the report of the. I don't think we move to accept the human resources healthcare budget. We did. We moved to approve the increase, but I looked back and I couldn't find. Did we? No, we didn't.
Okay.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Krumek. Is there a second?
Second.
By Ms. Tarkington. All in favor?
Aye.
Question.
Yes.
Do we want, you know, we've had them come maybe now for 2 years to present this healthcare report. Maybe we should just have them send us the report, because I don't know that it's necessary for them to come to the meetings every month.
I mean,
it's whatever the pleasure of the board is. I think we want to make the best use of our staff's time and not overexhaust them.
I mean, it doesn't seem like we discuss much, and I think questions can get answered. And I would propose that they just submit the report, and if they're and generally not attend unless asked to.
Why don't we do it that if members receive the materials on Thursday, if they have any questions, they direct them through email to the director and copy me so that I know, and we can make a determination. They don't have to attend.
I think that would be my.
Thank you. So Mr. Gortney welcomes questions through email to him. He's taking his vacation time to share his talents.
I move the report, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. It's moved by Mr. Walco to accept the report. Is there a second? Seconded by Ms. Tarkington. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
committee and liaison reports. I just want to jump ahead of Leslie, and I see Bob has a report from audit. Leslie, is your HR report concluded, or do you have you'll have additional?
Well, I thought the 401k plan issue.
Just want to confirm that. I just want to report on the Glenville School Building Committee briefly. Last month, I mentioned that the building committee had interviewed a number of architectural firms. The following day, the committee voted on hiring Perkins Eastman as the architect for the project, and the final costs were subject to negotiations. They were in the middle of terms of price, the firms that bid on the project, but the chair of the committee, Frank Mazza, and one of the members was going to see if the firm would sharpen their pencil a little bit and refine their costs. So we'll know the final agreed upon architectural costs most likely tomorrow at the next meeting. But that is where that stands at this moment. Okay, Mr. Stone, the audit committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The audit committee met on the 15th of June. First item taken up was a review of the report concerning parking violations and meter collections. This was the result of a request from the new parking services director, and it's a follow-up to internal audit's report delivered in October 2003. Much of the substance, including recommended courses of action concerning processes and controls, had been included in that 2003 report, which for various reasons had not been acted upon. In marked contrast, no pun intended, the internal auditor described the new director of parking services as proactive and indicated that many of the items found in the new audit have already been addressed. The committee voted unanimously to accept and release the report for distribution, and I recommend that you read it if you have not already done so. Concerning payroll audit findings, as reported in April and again last month, internal audit's findings comprised a variety of deficiencies involving both record-keeping and payroll procedures in several departments, which exposed the town to possible financial loss. Our committee advised the first selectman of our interests that corrective action be taken in a more timely manner than that originally indicated in the report, and we continue to await a response. Concerning the 401k MC contribution match, that will be discussed later this evening in a report from HR by Mrs. Tarkenton. And just to say on that, there was a conclusion that particular item be part of an overall study, which will be discussed. But there had been an observation by Mr. Simon during the course of our meeting that it was his understanding that the proposed policy proposed by HR is not consistent with a reasonable interpretation of what the BET had passed in 1997. In any case, we're advised that the entire package, et cetera, will be discussed later on this evening. The committee accepted the concept of a monthly report that we'll be asking the internal auditor to provide concerning follow-up procedure regarding actions taken concerning findings included in earlier internal audit reports. Finally, the controller reported that due to the prolonged illness of a member of the finance department, the internal auditor is going to be asked to temporarily assist with other departmental work. I pointed out to the controller that internal audits activities are considered as particularly high return by many in the financial community, but that he would have to use his best judgment as to where the internal auditor was of greatest value to the town. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Stone. Now, Mrs. Tarkington, we're back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Human Resources Committee met on June 1, and all the committee members were present, as well as Mr. Minarski, Ms. Cast, and Mr. Gomo. The meeting began with the way it's beginning every meeting now, with a discussion of the town's vacancy report and understanding what positions have been posted, et cetera, and most of those, the vacant, current vacant positions are in the process of being filled. The HR committee also reviewed and recommended the policy memorandum for the management and confidential employees 401k plan. The review also included discussion of IRS policies, and the memo that's been prepared, I'll comment here that Mr. Simon was actively involved in, I guess, most of the construction of this memo, but the committee has had input into it since. The memo codified an actual practice policy that has been in place. Finally, or not quite finally, but almost at, well, finally at our request, Ms. Cass prepared a draft chart of various benefits for the MC employees for three different employee levels. This chart will continue to be modified with additional information in future meetings. And some of that information includes just a thought process of what we should think of in terms of how the town employees are compensated. And we'll be learning things from, say, the McGladrey and Pullen study for allocations for Nathaniel Witherall. So that's just one example. And then I guess Ms. Cass shared at the end the preliminary draft for the RFP for the benchmarking study for the MC employees. So that is underway. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Tarkington. Are there any other committee or liaison reports? I do want to mention that we received from the controller in our mailing this evening a memorandum regarding the OPEB fund. The memo that was addressed to you, Mr. Minarski. I just want to point out that, and it may come up in your report, that that item may require action by the board. And one of the suggestions I'm going to make is that the ad hoc committee on OPEB, which is comprised of the budget committee as well as the investment liaisons and Mr. Stone, for continuity purposes, work with you to address some of the issues that were raised in that.
Just a follow-up. In the mailing that went out last week, there was a two-page email from Ed Jobo to myself. Through the mail, we got some attachments. So what I've done is I've got a complete package handed out in front of me. Some of you got more than one of your emails. So disregard the two-page email.
Great. So at this time, your report is before us. So seeing that there are no other committee or liaison reports, item number six, controller's report.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Do you have the copy of the June report? I will answer any questions at this time.
Mr. Walco?
If we can just stay on the topic of the ad hoc OPEB committee with respect to the email that you just referenced. So we need to we'll schedule a meeting and have that discussion. I think it would be worthwhile, however, to have your opinion with respect to that email. The email is from the town administrator to you. And so I think it would be important before the meeting take place if you could distribute to the and the ad hoc, as the chairman indicated, is comprised of the budget committee, the investment committee, and Mr. Stone. So if you could email your response, for lack of a better term, to that email, that would be productive.
To Ed Gomo's email?
Yes. Okay. Just interesting to know if you agree with it, if you think that, if you have other suggestions. I know there was a suggestion regarding the composition of the trustee. I think in order to keep the dialogue going, it would be interesting and noteworthy to have your opinion with respect to that before we meet.
Yes.
And then off of your email, then we can start an email chain regarding potential dates. I know that might be a little complicated as we get into the summer months, so I'd like to get that done sooner rather than later.
Okay.
And if I may, just one other point. Yes. So the we have yet to schedule a meeting with respect to outcome-based budgeting. So can we attempt to schedule that for the month of July?
We need to establish who is going to be on the ad hoc committee, and then I could send it out to the makeup. I believe Ed Gomo would be a representative from the First Selectman's office. Of course, the First Selectman's invited. Would it be similar in makeup to the BET ad hoc committee, where you might have two Democratic and two Republican members from the BET? I just need to know the composition.
I think I envisioned in the beginning of the term having at a minimum two people. I don't know about four. It would depend upon, you know, manpower and people's ability and willingness to serve on it. I was going to speak to Ms. Rutgers about it in terms of working through assignments. Certainly the budget committee, the two members of the budget committee need to be on it. I think that's the core. And then looking beyond that, if there's interest on the part of other members, we can solicit, the two of us can solicit that.
So I guess the short answer is we'll get back to you in the next few days, and I'd like to get that meeting scheduled as soon as possible, because I think it's an important aspect of moving forward.
Thank you. Other questions? Mr. Himes?
To put a slightly finer point on Steve's request for an opinion on Ed's memo, one area I would urge particular focus on, if it is in fact necessary that we establish a separate trust with a separate board of trustees for the OPEB account, that still leaves open the question of who appoints those trustees. Ed's recommendation is that the Board of Selectmen do so. And he bases that recommendation on the notion that the Board of Selectmen are responsible for the administration of benefits. If that is true, it would seem that there has been an error in the tradition and that this board has overseen that fund to date. So either that was in fact an error, or we would be transferring fiduciary control to the Board of Selectmen. If we could just have clarity on that with respect to who now should appoint the trustees, that would be very helpful.
Yes.
Further questions? Mr. Simon?
I mean, the memo doesn't say, the memo states that he recommends that the Board of Selectmen be the trustees, not that the Board of Selectmen appoint the trustees.
That's right.
But I think the BET still controls this fund. I don't think this belongs to any other entity but the BET at the moment.
You're right that that's the way it reads. Then, if that is in fact his recommendation, then we should get clarity on the fourth condition he says we must abide by, which is that plan assets are under stewardship of a legally separate entity. Which
we just need to establish a board of trustees.
And again, I think this will be the recommendation and purview to recommend of this ad hoc group that it, in a sense, is in existence already. But this is something for them to take up and address, for which Mr. Himes is a member, so have an opportunity to participate. Does any other members have questions on the comptroller's report? If not, is there a motion to accept it?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Walker. Seconded by Mr. Stone. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The treasurer's report for the period of May 1st to May 31st. Are there any questions?
I have one comment.
Mr. Simon?
I just want to thank the Finance Department. I find that this report is actually so much clearer than the previous reports that I can understand where the money is. I especially like the fact that we found $900,000 belonging to the retirement fund that was just sitting in our books, which is a plus.
Ms. Caldwell is smiling, so
I know she's smiling.
It made
you got to make something to make
all the more
smile.
Worthwhile.
But we did find the $900,000, and but I find the report to be really very helpful, and I thank you,
Mr. Norton.
I'd just like to reiterate the comments I made last month in regard to this report. I think it's a substantial improvement, a very large improvement over what we previously were receiving.
Great, thank you. Mr. Minarski?
Just to remind the board, the April report was never approved, so I think even though it's not posted on the agenda, that if you can, either you approve April and May or May to date. I don't know if it's required that you have to approve the treasurer's report.
It was on the agenda last month. It was listed on the agenda last month. We could put it under old business, but we have to vote to take it up. So right now we're at the point where we're approving May. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
It's moved and seconded.
This moved by Mr. Simon, seconded by Mr. Norton.
I didn't know that we have to approve it.
Accepted.
When we approve May, we're essentially approving May month and May year to date.
Yeah. Okay, minutes. Approval of minutes for the May 15th regular meeting. Do we have a motion?
So
moved by Mr. Finger, seconded by Mr. Walco. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Under officers' report, I prepared, with the help of Angie Marino in the Finance Department, a draft for the calendar 2007. We, at our July meeting, approved the meeting calendar for the upcoming year. I wanted members to have an opportunity to look at this and review it and advise of any potential conflicts with certainly religious holidays, which Ann takes into consideration, federal and state holidays, as well as school vacations. We typically are scheduled to meet the third Monday of the month, and we tie into a sequence of meetings, as you see with RTM, whereby we're acting on something 1 month and it leaves enough time to get it to RTM for approval. If members have any comments they can or suggested changes, I would suggest route them through Ann. The one other question I wanted to pose to members that we briefly touched upon, I think, at the beginning of the term was whether there was a preference or not in moving the starting time of the meetings next year to 6:30. Historically, up until I think 3 years ago, the board began their meetings at 8 p.m. And I think we found since we moved to 7 p.m., we have had more alert debate and discussion, and it's afforded better opportunity for people to get home and spend time with their families. So I'm certainly open to it. Personally, I would support going to 6:30. Half hour is meaningful to me, but it's, again, whatever the prerogative of the board is. If you want to think about it and include that in your communication, do so. I know in the past we were sensitive to an earlier start time for those who commute, and we need to take that into consideration as well. So we'll plan on doing that at our July meeting. Mr. Walco?
Mr. Chairman, just to dovetail off of your comments, the Budget Committee has reviewed a draft of the budget schedule. Roland, if you could distribute that to all of the BET members, as I think it's important that if you have comments with respect to the budget schedule, that you it'd be worthwhile to exercise just to review that as well and give us any feedback. We intend to vote on that timeline at our July meeting as well.
And under another item for consideration is we do have a meeting scheduled in the month of August. It is the policy of the board, the practice, that we do schedule meetings every month. But in fact, the last number of years since I've been on the board, which is now 8 going on 9 years, I think the August meeting, regular meeting, has been canceled almost every year. So if there's no preference or no desire for members to be here in August, we can proceed to cancel that meeting and in doing so notify the web and so forth of informing the public, because it is up on the agenda. And I know I want to make sure I afford Mr. Crummick enough time to hit the campaign trail, so I'm lobbying to cancel the meeting.
You mean edforrep.com?
And by the
yes, edforrep.com.
And by the way, I can't resist that. The only reason why I think he refers to me as Mr. Chairman now is because he figured out that I reside in his district and I'm a voter, so.
I did notice that.
So, Mr. Crummick?
Well, we could move the meeting in August to Nantucket. It would be videotaped.
There we go.
But all things considered, I think we should continue our fine tradition of not having an August meeting if we don't have to.
Okay. I was looking for Mr. Lash, since he's such affinity for the BET, to move it up to Maine for August, but he won't be there that week. Mr. Simon.
Yeah, when you get the budget calendar, you'll see that the dates for the, at least the proposed dates for the public hearing is March 20th, and the date for the decision day is March 21st. So people should be prepared to vote on those also in July.
That is correct. We deferred to you on that because you seem to drive the budget calendar, but in fact the board approves those dates. You're right. Thank you for pointing that out. I have no other items under the officer's report. Mr. Stone, do you have anything? Ms. Rutgers, do you have anything? Okay. Proceeding to old business.
Is in fact the August meeting canceled?
Yes, the August meeting is canceled. I don't see anyone jumping up. We last month, under new business, had a first reading of a policy regarding cost of living adjustments for retirees. That was generated by the Budget Committee, and members were asked to get comments back to them. I don't know if we'll refer to Mr. Walco if in fact they did, but our intent at least was to act this month on it. Now, it did not make it onto the agenda. If members do want to take it up, I believe the only way we can do it is if we vote to take it up.
By two-thirds.
Right. So Mr. Crummick is moving to take it up. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, so it is now under old business. And Mr.
Somebody
second. Yes, Mr. Crummick and Mr. Mason. If you can report as to whether or not you in fact did receive any further comments on it, changes.
My report will be brief. I received no comments or changes. And so I believe this is before us for our second reading and final adoption to be added as a BET policy regarding cost of living adjustments for retirees.
Is there any comments on it?
And I so move the item.
Okay, it's moved by Mr. Walco.
Second.
Second by Mr. Crummick. Mr. Crummick.
I noticed among the materials that Ms. Cast had provided to us was a sample of the collective bargaining agreement that dealt with COLA increases in that particular contract, and I think that just brings home the fact that that in keeping up with the negotiation of the collective bargaining agreements, that we should adopt this policy and exclude from the ad hoc COLA increases for people that are covered by collective bargaining agreements with COLA provisions.
Okay, thank you. Further comments? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carries 12-0-0. I would ask the Finance Department to make sure this is inserted into our policy manual and see to it that the town clerk has a copy of it, and that a copy is sent to the moderator and moderator pro tem of the RTM in light of the fact that the subject is under review by that body in a special committee. I know Ms. Caldwell has been tracking it and is here tonight, but in fact she should receive a formal copy of it at her home. Is there any other business to come before the meeting? If not, may I have a motion to adjourn?
Excuse me, Mr. Moderator. I have one other item. Mr. Chairman, Mr. Married Man, soon. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Wish you the best.
Good Is that on the calendar?
That's why I canceled the August meeting.
You want to come to Hawaii? You can come.
So moved. Jim's coming to that one.
All right, so motion to adjourn.
Motion to congratulate.
Thank you.